Writing on the Edge is a collection of 14 first-hand accounts of life inside conflict zones, where Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières, or MSF, provides emergency medical care. The book takes readers on a harrowing tour of countries in crisis, profiling people struggling to cope with war, disease, and a lack of basic health care. Award-winning photographer Tom Craig teamed up with MSF and an international roster of 14 highly esteemed and widely traveled writers, directors, and actors. They visited various MSF projects worldwide, returning with poignant visual and narrative accounts of their experiences.
The idea really was that the writers would be taken completely out of their comfort zone. And in doing that, they would personally be moved to write about the people they saw, the individuals they met, the work that was being done. And in many ways, I wanted them to be afraid. I wanted them to miss their home. I wanted them to feel like they were, you know, extremely hot in the middle of Africa or extremely cold in the middle of Armenia. I wanted them to be totally removed from whatever it was that they knew about that was a comfortable European or Western existence. And this book is a collection of 14 of those journeys which I made with each of the writers, visiting different MSF projects each time. And all these people involved in these stories, whilst they're sad and traumatic and difficult to listen to, they are improved by the presence of MSF, and that's the point. The book's about the fact that amazing work is being done to make bad situations better. I traveled to Burundi with novelist Tracy Chevalier, who has written many books, amongst others, The Girl with the Pearl Earring. And Burundi was one of the hardest of all the trips for many reasons, but particularly because in this particular case we were visiting victims of sexual violence in Burundi. Sadly, sexual violence is more or less considered a weapon of war there, and the number of cases where sexual violence has been an issue are countless. So it was extremely difficult, extremely intense, and very, very hard to do as a man with a camera to go to a clinic which was exclusively full of women and girls who had been attacked by men and arrive and try to do what I could to take photographs without being intrusive, without being intimidating. On one occasion we went to meet a mother and daughter. Beatrice was the mother and Christine was the daughter. And Christine had been raped just before her third birthday. And I can't describe, you know, how I felt then, and indeed really how I feel now about it, because it's too much, really. It wasn't just one isolated case. We heard stories like that again and again and again. And I think in the end, we just felt like we couldn't hear any more stories because they were too terrible. Well, Tracy was incredible, actually. Just seeing her talk to these children and talk to these women, she managed to find a way to put them at ease very quickly. I witnessed that at a number of occasions. And one of the ways that she went about it, I remember, is by showing these women and children photographs of her own family. And I think immediately it just introduced her as, you know, as a mother and as a mother figure and a human and a family member and someone that just really felt for the situation that they were in, and it was an amazing what an effect it had. In the chapter for Burundi, there are a couple of images that seem very simple at first glance, and it's when you get under the skin of what's going on, you realize just how traumatic they are. There is another picture of a child. It's quite an innocent picture about play, really. And it's a five-year-old girl, and she's just playing with these wooden figures. And they look at first like just toys, like dolls, or for someone just to play a game with. But in actual fact, again, when you get behind the image, you discover that it's a five-year-old girl that's been raped by a grown man. And in actual fact, the wooden figures are used by the psychologists and the team in the clinic to help the child describe what went on. In Burundi, as with many of the projects we visited, it may be that no one would be there to help them if it wasn't for MSF. So when I was really thinking about what the book meant and why I did it, I couldn't remember the number of people that had been helped or saved, because there were too many in my experience throughout the book. There were too many individuals who'd actually had their lives saved, or their daughter's life saved, or their father's life saved. And whilst many of their names and faces come to mind, there was a huge number of individuals that were helped and saved by MSF on our travels. And that applied to each of the contributors for sure. And each and every one of them would pick out specific individuals that embodied the crises that they were involved in, whether it was gang violence in Colombia, or shortage of water in the refugee camps of Chad, or mental health in Armenia, multi-drug resistant tuberculosis in Uzbekistan. Each trip we made gave rise to specific individuals who embodied not only some sort of resilience or bravery, but also embodied the work that MSF were doing to try to help them.